Well, thank you everyone for coming. It's good to see everyone here. We're going to be getting into the Daniel chapter 11 today. After having a nice full lunch, you think you can... I want to share some principles from the Word of God.
Gone.
You got it, Rick?
Yep.
I want to share some principles and I guess open up some of the challenges that I've faced in dealing with prophecy in terms of history and how it applies to us today. I want to read to you a number of statements from the spirit of prophecy and scripture in relationship to this subject. And you're right. and hopefully it will stir us up to study more deeply about the prophecies. I think that if any of us are looking around at what's going on in the world today, there's some pretty major stuff happening and is about to happen. I think we're all pretty well aware of that. So understanding the sequence in the book of Daniel about what's happening would be really, really good for us to know. And there's a lot of voices crying out at the moment about different things in Daniel Revelation. So I want to open it up. I know that some of you here have also done some research and study. This is not so much a lecture, but I'll share some of where I'm coming from, and maybe we can jump in and have a look at a few more things. So for those who can get to the floor, if we can... we have a few more seats up the front here. So. If other people come in late.
There's a cold zone.
Oh, the cold zone.
Oh, yeah.
Let's pray. Yeah. Father in heaven, we just thank you that we can come before you. We pray that as we study the Word of God, that your Spirit would lead us and guide us and teach us. And I just pray that you'd help us to work together on some of these things. Some of these things in Scripture are difficult. And we don't want to give a premature answer to things before we've studied them out. And we just thank you for hearing this prayer in Jesus' name. I think what I'd like to do is welcome Craig. Come here, mate. We've kept the seat.
Oh, you, right, you get the leather one, mate.
Oh, that's all real.
If anybody has not aware of the little book, Divine Pattern of Life, we have a number of copies. I have been, just to give a brief summary, and for those that are new to this, I'm sorry if this is a bit quick, but for the sake of our study, we are presenting the thought that there is a pattern that is based on the text in 1 Corinthians 8:6. And that is, 1 Corinthians 8:6 says, "For unto us there is but one God, the Father, of whom are all things, of whom, and we are." How does the rest of the text go? The word in the Greek for "of" is the word "ek," of whom are all things, and one Lord Jesus Christ, by whom are all things, by whom. And it's all things are of the Father, all things are by, and the word in the Greek is dia, through. Everything comes of the Father, through the Son. And what we're suggesting is that many, many things in this creation, because we are told that man was created in the image of God, and that... It says that God created all things by Jesus Christ. It says that in Hebrews chapter 1. In terms of the way that each one of us are brought into this world, each one of us, the seed of the Father given to our mother of our Father, because it's the Father that determines the sex of whether we're a boy or a girl, to the mother, and then we come into life. So it's this pattern that's operating. We see it in the Bible itself. The Bible is one book, but it is in two testaments. The New Testament is an expansion and a magnification of the Old Testament. Old Testament is root New Testament is fruit. That's what it says in Christ Object Lesson. So, and we can look at many, many other things, like the sanctuary. You have the holy place and the most holy place. How do you enter the most holy place? You go through to the most holy place. Jesus says, I am the way to the Father. No man comes unto the Father except by me, John 14:6. We also see the relationship between the Bible and the spirit of prophecy. The spirit of prophecy is designed to lead us to the scriptures, to point us to the scriptures. And so this is a pattern that occurs over and over and over in scripture. Now Satan has developed another pattern. In Isaiah 14 verse 13, what did Satan say? I will what? I will ascend. I will be like the Most High, which means that he would be his own source, of whom are all things in his reality. He would be co-equal, he would be co-eternal with the Father. And that creates a tension between the two sources. Who is the great original? Who is the source? And of course, when you are looking at two sources like this, the human mind does interesting things to try and harmonize this tension. Satan said he would ascend into the sides of the north. If the Father is sitting on the north and Satan wants to ascend into the sides of the north and you put two ends of the North Pole together, what happens?
Repel.
But the position of Jesus, the sweet submission of Jesus, he always does. S for submission, S for the South Pole. There's South Pole in connection to the North Pole. When the Son comes to the Father, there's a connection. There's a strong connection because of the submissive spirit of the Son. But Satan creates an atmosphere of repulsion because of wanting to be like the Most High, wanting to be the same as God. And one of the ways that man has tried to harmonize in dealing with this God of this world, as we have seen, is the yin-yang symbol, which is a way of trying to harmonize two things that don't harmonize together. Greeks developed what they call dialectic thinking. Have you heard of dialectics? Or Hegelian principle, thesis, antithesis? It's taking two opposites and just making them fit. As an aside to this, if you read the latest, the last Pope's encyclical on love, he talks about God being eros combined with agape. Now, eros is the Greek form of love, that where attraction takes place. It's a selfish kind of love. It pleases me. And Rome says that agape is a giving love, which is completely opposite. And he says God is a combination of those two things. That's a yin and a yang principle, trying to put those two things together. And so let's turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We're just laying a bit of ground before we go to Daniel. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 3. Susanna, can you read?
Whatever our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost.
In whom? Keep reading.
In whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, is the image of God, should shine unto them.
You see, the God of this world, the God of this world was the God that says, I will ascend into heaven and I will create a pattern of thinking that is co-equal, that is two completely identical beings. But that creates a tension of worship. It stops the flow. That's the God of this world. As opposed to Jesus, as it says here in verse 4, who is the image of the invisible God, begotten of the Father, brought forth from the Father. He is the channel of whom, by whom rather, are all things. But because of when Satan spoke to our first parents in the garden. He said, ye shall be what? As? You shall ascend by eating the fruit of this tree. You will ascend into the highest realm. You will be like the Most High because you will be as gods. God reveals himself as one. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. No, Lucifer says, you will be as gods. There is more than one God. And for many, there's three gods. But that's not what the scripture teaches. So, this pattern of thinking, and I just want to give one illustration where this pattern of thinking can confuse us, and we want to go to the example of the Old Testament and the New Testament. If we have a wrong pattern in our mind of the God that we serve, this pattern will manifest itself in all the smaller patterns. So come to John 1:17, this will be familiar for some of you. Now, I don't know if we've got some modern translations, but the King James will provide an interesting analysis of the relationship between law and grace, or law and the gospel, or Old Testament and New Testament. Simon, you got that.
Oh, sorry, that's the one time I don't.
You are forgiven.
I've just switched to the electronic side, so I'm a bit behind. Next one.
Heather,
have
you
got it? 17. Yep. The law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ.
I like that. What version is that?
ESV.
So the law was given by Moses, grace and truth by Jesus Christ. Does anyone have the KJV?
It says, but the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came.
So we have law, and then we have this word but, and then we have grace. What's the relationship between law and grace in this sentence?
Opposite.
So you've got an oppositional mindset. The problem is, in the King James, is what's the font of that little word?
Italics.
It's italics. Shouldn't be there. It shouldn't be there. So as I say to the King James translators, get your butt out of there. So
in my New King James, it says through Moses.
Through Moses. So read it.
It says, for the law was given through Moses, but grace and truth came through Jesus Christ.
So but. So it's putting a parallel. It's saying the law came through Moses, but grace as a separate entity came through Jesus Christ, completely unrelated. And but if we look, if we look at, say, texts like Proverbs 13, can't remember, it says the law of the wise is a fountain of life. There's life coming from the fountain. And when we think about grace, why do we need grace? Because of the law. So grace comes because of law. If there wasn't a law, you wouldn't need grace. So for the law came by Moses, grace and truth by Jesus Christ. And so what I'm saying is that one pattern of thinking is creating an oppositional, the God of this world creating an opposition between law and grace. The other one is showing that there's a causal relationship where law and grace, or grace leading to law, it's a causal relationship with one in submission to the other. Does that make sense? Yeah? Hebrews 7:19, look at one more example. Look for the supplied word. Hebrews 7:19.
Go.
You got that one, Simon?
Yep. In the New King James.
Alright, New King James, what does that say?
For the law made nothing perfect. On the other hand, in italics, there is the bringing in of a better hope through which we draw near to God.
Okay, so there's the law and there's the better hope. What's the better hope?
Grace,
the gospel. Uh-huh. So it's, on the one hand, the law made nothing perfect. On the other hand, there's a better hope. That's creating a conflict between the law. But what does Psalms 19 say about the law?
Wow.
The law of the Lord is perfect. And what does it do? Convert the soul. How does the law convert the soul?
Where sin abounds.
Where sin abounds, grace does much more abound. The law is our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. So, can someone read the King James? Just, have you got a King James?
For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God.
And do you have did in italics?
Yes.
So if you take out the word did, you get this: for the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope. So the law has a causal relationship with the better hope. The law that was our schoolmaster to bring us to Christ. There's a causal relationship. There's a source-channel relationship going on. But again, if you add the word did, the law made nothing perfect, out, but the bringing in of a better hope did. That creates an oppositional mindset. And I would like to suggest to you that many, many people are reading the Bible with a pattern of thinking that is oppositional. And oppositional thinking causes us tremendous difficulty. There's a lot of conflict and discussion going on because clearly there are evidences that the better hope is distinct from the law. And but there are verses that talk clearly about the keeping of the commandments of God, and that we need to keep the law of God, and we need to be faithful to the law. But then we have texts saying that, you know, the law made nothing perfect. Therefore, well, without the law, receiving the righteousness of Christ without the law.
The Young's literal actually has an end as opposed to a but.
Oh, there you go. Has an end. So, can you read that?
Indeed, the context from 18 it says, "For it disannulling indeed doth come of the come of the command going before, because of its weakness and unprofitableness in brackets, for nothing did the law perfect, and the bringing in of a better hope through which we draw nigh to God."
Okay, I think I followed that.
Yeah, it's a bit confusing.
I'm not sure. So the point I'm making is that there are many opposition things that are oppositional that don't need to be oppositional. And, you know, like, saved by grace alone. Is that right? Are we saved by grace alone? For what purpose? Saved through grace alone in order that we may... Here are they that keep the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. We can look in Philippians chapter 2. That Christ has a name above every name. We stop there? Well, that means he's even more important than the Father, doesn't it?
Mm-hmm.
If we stop there, he has a name above every name. That's what it says. But then what does it say? To the glory of who? To the glory of God the Father. So we want to beware when we're looking at oppositional statements. So, with that background in mind, I would like to go to Matthew 24 and let's dig around. I want to look at a few things. Matthew 24. If anyone wants to dig more into the divine pattern, we've got, come and grab some copies if you want to understand a bit more about that. Matthew 24. So, let's come to verse 14. And we're up to... Eddie, you going to read that?
14. "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come."
What is this?
Must be at the end of the world.
Is this the end of the world? "And this gospel of the kingdom shall be preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then what?
The end
shall come." Okay, so is verse 15 connected to verse 14?
Yes.
Hmm?
I hope so.
John, have you got verse 15?
"Therefore, when you see the abomination of desolation
spoken of by Daniel the prophet standing in the holy place. Whoever reads, they can understand.
So when's that?
The end.
Before the end.
In the gospel is
the end of Jerusalem. Some say it's past.
Okay, so now, good, hang on a minute. If it says, and then the end shall come, when you therefore, if you're using the word therefore, you're connecting it to the previous statement, which was about the end, when you therefore shall see the abomination of desolation stand in the holy place, whosoever readeth, let him understand. But, as you said, Ron, if we come to Luke chapter 21, we get something that is said there. Luke chapter 21. It's 20. I wanted to point out that in Matthew 24 it goes on to say that fleeing, it's fleeing, the next thing is fleeing, it's the next quote, so this is related. So
it says then, so it's before they start to flee.
Okay, is this in Matthew?
Yeah, Matthew 16.
Then let them.
So when you see the abomination, after the gospel has been preached to the whole world, abomination of desolation, then. That's the sequence that's offered in Matthew.
Mm-hmm.
So what does it say in Luke 21, 20 and 21? Have you got that set on?
And when ye shall see Jerusalem compassed with armies, then know that the desolation thereof is nigh. Then let them which are in Judea flee to the mountains, and let them which are in the midst of it depart out. And let not them that are in the countries enter thereinto.
Okay. So this is talking about the destruction of Jerusalem, isn't it? Is that right?
Yes.
9:27, for the overspreading of abominations. This is in Daniel 9:27. So we've got Matthew 24, and then you've got Luke 21. Now here's where the pattern that you're operating by. Are we going to take an oppositional platform and say it's all at the time of the end? And we're just going to find some way to eliminate Luke? Or are we going to say it's all happening in the time of Jerusalem and we're going to eliminate what's happening, what Matthew seems to be saying, that it's directly related to the time of the end? And because most of us are schooled in oppositional thinking, I know that. Because I remember when I was a teenager and how I dealt with my parents. I'm schooled in oppositional thinking. So it just makes perfect sense to pick one and exclude the other. But could there be a different relationship? If we bring the father and son relationship, of whom are all things, that Luke could be a source and that Matthew could be a channel, an expansion, an intensification of what happened in the time of the destruction of Jerusalem. Is that possible?
Yeah.
But there's a different pattern going on here. And doesn't it say, in Great Controversy, that the destruction of Jerusalem is a pattern for what will happen at the end of time? And so she's saying there's a repeat of history taking place. So we don't need to pit Luke 21 against Matthew 24. But that Luke 21 is providing a type or an example of what's going to come in an intensified manner at the end of time. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
So the question then that needs to be asked is Matthew actually suggesting that we're going to see the abomination of desolation just before the end of time?
Mm-hmm.
Is that what it's possibly suggesting to us?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So again, if our minds are in an oppositional mindset, if we agree with that, then there can be this feeling of inertia that says, you're destroying this, if you have an oppositional mindset. But if we say, well, maybe both of them are related to each other. And I think most people who read Matthew 24 realize that there's there's at least two ideas going on there. Two, at the time of the destruction of Jerusalem and of the end of the world. And what were the questions that the disciples asked Jesus? What shall be the sign of thy coming?
End of the age.
There's two things. When shall these things be? Because he says, there shall be not one stone left here upon another shall be thrown down. When shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of their coming and the end of the world? He asked two questions and they put them together in one. In Luke, it answers the local situation of when shall these things be? When shall there be not one stone left upon another? That's when the army shall surround Jerusalem. And what is the sign of thy coming, end of the world? When the image of the beast is set up and the abomination of desolation is manifested itself in its final fulfillment. So then we need to ask ourselves some questions. And I'd like to look at the scriptures first in Ecclesiastes chapter 3:15, I think it is.
We eventually get to Daniel 11, don't we?
Eventually. We've got to set the stage.
Yeah.
Thank you for your patience.
No, I'm not complaining.
I didn't hear any complaints. We've just lost our blessing. I'm going to put that back up. I'm going to put that back up. What is it? Is it Ecclesiastes 3:15? What are we up to? Hannah, have you got that?
Ecclesiastes 3:15.
I think that's what it is.
That which hath been is now, and that which is to be hath already happened, already been. And God requireth that which is past.
Okay. It talks about this principle of the repeating of history in Ecclesiastes 3. And now I want to read you a few statements. From the Spirit of Prophecy. Manuscript Release 54, the Lord has declared that the history of the past shall be rehearsed as we enter upon the closing work. Here's another. Again and again I've been shown that the past experiences of God's people are not to be counted as dead facts. We are not to treat the record of these experiences as we would treat last year's almanac. The record is to be kept in mind, for history will repeat itself. In the history and prophecy, that's Publishing Ministry 175. In the history and prophecy of the Word of God, the Word of God portrays the long-continued conflict between truth and error. That conflict is yet in progress. Those things which have been will be repeated. That's 1 MR 47. And I'm just quickly going through, for the time is at hand when past history will be repeated. Bear in mind, this is 13 MR 380, bear in mind history is being repeated. The perils that God's people encountered in past ages, they will encounter again, intensified. So we see the principle of something occurring, and then occurring again, intensified, magnification. See, the sun is the brightness of the Father's glory. When you get something that's more brilliant and more bright, is that an intensification?
Mm-hmm.
So she says, with history will encounter again, intensified. And here's another statement, 7 MR 417. All the great events and solemn transactions of Old Testament history have been and are repeating themselves in the church in these last days. That's an interesting statement, isn't it? In these last days. Now, this is where we come to Daniel. This is what you're waiting for, Simon. The prophecy in the 11th of Daniel has nearly reached its complete fulfillment. So the actual prophecy itself, as it goes through from the time of Darius the Mede, the Great, verse 2 and 3, or Darius before the Greeks, it's almost reached its complete fulfillment. Then it says, much of the history that has taken place in fulfillment of this prophecy will be repeated. just need to take in the implications of that statement. So, Daniel 11 has nearly been completed, but much of this prophecy will be repeated. So the original has nearly completed, but much of it will be repeated. How does that work? Has Daniel 11 fully exhausted itself in its original? Is verse 45, has there been a placing between the holy mountain and the mountain of God and the sea? Has that taken place yet? No. So verse 45 has not unfolded yet. But she's saying here that much of the history that has taken place in fulfillment of this prophecy will be repeated. So that's something that is interesting. Now, the visions, this is another quote in 4 BC, 1166, written in 1896. The visions he saw by Daniel by the banks of the Ulai and the Hiddekel, the great rivers of Shinar, are now in process of fulfillment. Really? Oh, that's right. In 8, he was in Shushan by the river Ulai, but in chapter 10, he's by the Hiddekel. And so there's a wrestling. There's a wrestling going on, and as to whether Cyrus will let God's people go. He's saying this history is being repeated. She wrote that in 1896. I wonder what context she was offering for that. That's interesting. We could read a lot more, but I just want to go now to this thought that the 11th of Daniel has nearly reached its fulfillment. I want to read a little bit more of this because it will give us a clue, because this taps into the abomination of desolation.
Can you say one more time where it is?
13 MR 394. Much of the history that has taken place in fulfillment of this prophecy will be repeated. Then she says, in the 30th verse, a power is spoken of that shall be grieved and return and have indignation against the Holy Covenant. So shall he do. He shall even return and have intelligence with them that forsake the Holy Covenant. And then she quotes verses 31 to 36. So all the way from verse 30 to verse 36, she quotes after saying much of the history of Daniel 11 will be repeated. So then she says, scenes similar to those described in these words will take place. We see evidence that Satan is fast obtaining the control of human minds who have not the fear of God before them. Let all read and understand the prophecies of this book, for we are now entering upon the time of trouble spoken of. And then she quotes Daniel 12, 1 to 4. Okay. So, are we ready to dive into Daniel 11? I'm going to save this and shut that down. Daniel chapter 11. Let's come to some areas that most of us, I think, should be familiar with. And verse 20. We're up to, you got that, Ben? 11:20.
11:20?
Yeah.
Then shall stand up in his estate a razor of axes in the glory of the kingdom, but within a few days he shall be destroyed, neither in anger nor in battle.
Who is the raiser of taxes? What does that remind us of? Do we know what time period this is?
It's in Rome.
Rome? Luke chapter 3, what does it say? There was a thing sent out that all the world should be taxed. Augustus Caesar. This is a reference to Augustus Caesar. That's my understanding. The previous verse 17 to 19 is referring to Julius Caesar and liaisons with Cleopatra. The marvellous Julius Caesar. Wonderfully, a little footnote, wonderfully
family man.
You know what we said about Julius Caesar? That he was the husband of every wife and the wife of every husband. That'll tell you a little bit about the perversion of that man. I think you're all stunned. That was pretty common for these guys. Talk about Alexander the Great. He sure was great. Verse 20, we talk about, so Julius Caesar, 17 to 19, Augustus Caesar, which follows him, around just before the time of the birth of Christ, and then of course when he was born, the tax was, and then in verse 21, who are we up to?
And in his place shall arise a vile person, to whom they will not give the honour of royalty, but he shall come to Rome peaceably and seize the kingdom by intrigue.
Okay, so who was after Augustus Caesar? We know our history, do we? Tiberius. He was not born of the royal line. I think he was adopted as a son. He was a servant, and he was a vile character.
What was his name?
Tiberius. Tiberius Caesar. And then there just happens to be a little footnote that takes place. So we're going through the history of the kingdoms, and it's describing in the first, from verse 2, 3, down to 16, or down to 13, we're talking about the war between the northern and the lower southern kingdoms of the Greeks, the Seleucids and the Ptolemies, in Syria, and in Egypt. Yeah, that's what I think too about the Tiberius. So, good on you. So, and I'm not going to go through all of that history just now, but we just want to follow through. Verse 22. Are we up to verse 22? Okay, so, yea, also the Prince of the Covenant. He shall be broken. Who's the Prince of the Covenant?
Jesus.
Jesus, Yeshua. And it says he'll be broken. When was he broken?
31 AD.
31 AD, cut off in the midst of the week. This is a reference to the crucifixion of Christ. Okay? And so, verse 23 then.
And after the league is made with him, he shall act deceitfully, for he shall come up and become strong with a small number of people.
Anybody know what this is talking about? It's after the crucifixion of Christ, we've had the three Caesars, Julius, Augustus, Tiberius. And during the reign of Tiberius, Christ is crucified. And then it says, after the league made with him, he shall work deceitfully, and he shall come up and shall be strong with a small people.
Herod?
Which Herod was that?
The one that was persecuting
Jesus. Well, this is where I want to introduce to you some history from. I have here. Haskell, Daniel the Prophet, and Daniel and Revelation by Uriah Smith. And these two men at this point divide. They go in different directions, which is helpful. do you want to know what Uriah Smith says about this? And again, we're diving into some deep history here, and I've been banging my head up against this for a while. So if you're not up to speed, that's all right. This is what he says. Rome makes a league with the Jews. The him with whom the league is made must be the same power which had been the subject of the prophecy from the 14th verse, the Roman Empire. This is true has been shown in fulfillment of the prophecy in the three individuals who successively ruled the empire, Julius, Augustus, and Tiberius. Now that the prophet has taken us through the secular events of the Roman Empire to the end of the 70 weeks of Daniel 9:24, he takes us back to the time when the Romans became directly connected with the people of God by the Jewish League in 161 BC. This is an important note. Uriah Smith is going, okay, the League, there was a League, the Jews made a League with the Romans in 161 BC to come under their protection. And Uriah Smith is doing a U-turn and he's going back, and that, which means that the next verses that come are a repeat of the history of Julius Augustus and Augustus Tiberius. He talks a lot about the war between Mark Antony and Augustus Caesar. Is anyone not familiar with the story? Remember the story of Mark Antony? What happened with Mark Antony? Mark Antony married the sister of Augustus Caesar, Octavia. And he was sent to rule the southern part of the kingdom. And when he went down to Egypt, guess who he ran into? Cleopatra. And he was captivated. And he divorced his wife, Octavia, which really didn't go down well in Rome. And they began to... they began the process of... Augustus and Mark Antony began the process of skullduggery and talking to one another and trying to get one-upmanship, a little bit like what we're seeing in the Mariana Straits, where China and America are starting to talk about who can drive their boats through that part of the world. A little bit of, as we'd say in Australian, argy-bargy going on. When Augustus comes down, Cleopatra has part of the army, and she's affrighted by the war, and she diverts her forces that she's under the control, that's under her control, and she goes off to the side, away from the war. Mark Antony was still in a good position, but when he saw Cleopatra leave the battle, he just took off and followed her. And of course, all of his soldiers thought, well, that was pathetic. So they left him and went and joined Augustus. And Antony took his life. And as it says, Cleopatra, she could have been the trophy. She could have been brought to Rome by Augustus and paraded before the people. But she managed to get herself bitten by a serpent. She died. So she didn't make it to the party. Now, that's the story that... Uriah Smith believes is a fulfillment of verses 24 to right through to 27. But maybe we should just read these verses now so we can bring ourselves up to speed. So we need to read verses 24 and 25. Where are we up to? Is that Igor?
He shall enter peaceably even upon the fattest places of the province, and he shall do that which his fathers have not done, nor his fathers' fathers. He shall stand among them the prey and spoil and the rich of Jacob, and he shall forecast his devices against the strongholds, even for a time.
Now that's an important verse, even for a time. When we're talking about time, you've heard of time, times, and half a time. If this is a time, this is a 360-year period that's being described here. It says in verse 25,
and he shall stir up his power and his courage against the king of the south with a great army. And the king of the south shall be stirred up to battle with the group. To battle with all very great and mighty ones, and he shall not stand, for they shall forecast devices against him.
Okay. And 26.
Yea, they that feed on the portion of his meat shall destroy him, and his army shall overflow, and men shall fall down slain.
Okay. So all of this, Uriah Smith is saying, this is the war between Mark Antony and Augustus Caesar that took place. Because the battle that they had between them, I think it was the Battle of Actium in 30 BC. In 30 BC, you go forward 360 years, and you come to 330 AD, which brings you to the time of Constantine. I can see some of you going, okay. I've had a little bit of pre-warning because I was reading this the last couple of nights at 11 o'clock at night. Riveting stuff! It's really, really good. But what's interesting is that I want you to notice something. Where is it? It mentions the Holy Covenant.
Verse
28. It is 28. So let's read 28. Have you got that, Esau?
And shall he return into his land, and the very interest of his heart shall be against the Holy Covenant, and he shall do it exploit and return to his own land.
Okay, so his heart shall be against the Holy Covenant. What is the Holy Covenant?
Is it the Everlasting Covenant?
The Everlasting Covenant, the covenant between God and his people. How? And this is where we need to ask a question. If this is... Well, the thing is that after Augustus, he defeated Mark Antony... He then goes and destroys, he goes and sacks Jerusalem and takes control of Jerusalem. And that's where Uriah Smith says, this is before the coming of Christ. And Jerusalem is the citadel of the covenant that God has made with his people. And in attacking Jerusalem, he's attacking the Holy Covenant. That's what he's saying is the fulfillment of that part of the prophecy. But then again, it says... verse 29, I'll read this, at the time appointed he shall return and come toward the south, but not he shall not be as the former or as the latter. And then we come to verse 30, and verse 30 is interesting because this is where Ellen White quotes when she says, much of this history will be repeated. So if we don't know what's going on in these particular verses, then when we come to verse 30, we won't know where to begin the repeat. Does that make sense? Will be lost in the context of what's going on. But it says that in verse 30, for the ships of Shittim shall come against him, therefore he shall be grieved and return and have indignation against the Holy Covenant. So shall he do, he shall even return and have intelligence with them that forsake the Holy Covenant. And what's interesting about Uriah Smith is that in verse 28, he says the Holy Covenant is the attack on Jerusalem, God's holy people. And then in verse 30, he says the Holy Covenant is what Rome started to do to the Scriptures. So there's a shift in his understanding. And it's particularly interesting to understand what Uriah Smith understood the Holy Covenant to be. That's another whole subject. In respect of the 1888 message and Uriah Smith's rejection of the Everlasting Covenant, his commentary on what the covenant is before and after the cross, I would suggest is a little bit dubious, or we should beware of what he says on that subject, knowing that when... Forgive me if this is too much detail. When Ellen White said to Uriah Smith, Wagner has the truth on the covenants, what you're doing is a waste of time. You're standing in the way of the light. And that he refused to accept that testimony. That puts him in a very serious situation. Because Wagner was teaching that God's covenant with his people is the same all the way through the Old Testament and the New Testament. Uriah Smith was saying that the Old Covenant is the Old Testament, the New Covenant is the New Testament. And he split it. And Ellen White said to him, "You're wrong. Wagner's right." And but Uriah Smith, the editor of the Review and Herald, and the great writer of the books of Daniel and Revelation, obviously didn't take that very well, and he resisted it. But that's another whole story. And this is where it's interesting, because I'd like to read to you what S.N. Haskell says about the Holy Covenant and about this time period from 24 onwards, because Haskell accepted the 1888 message, and he wrote this book in 1903, which was 2 years after Uriah Smith died, and maybe he waited out of respect for him, I don't know, before he released the book. This book here was, well, this is the 1994 edition that Leroy Froom has gotten to and dog-eared and torn up. But the 1897 edition, which that was the last edition that Uriah Smith brought out.
What's Haskell's book called again?
The Story of Daniel the Prophet. Story of Daniel the Prophet. And I've just printed out a few pages. Now, he's quoting verse 23, after the league that was made with him. This is what he says. There were many Christians scattered throughout the empire who refused to fight under the banner of paganism. With these, Constantine made a league. So Haskell is moving forward to the time of Constantine, and that Constantine, if we read the scriptures, and I think Haskell has a better grasp of this, where it says, verse 24, he shall enter peaceably even upon the fattest places of the province, and he shall do that which his fathers had not done. Did Constantine do what his fathers had not done?
Mm-hmm.
What did he do?
He
used Christianity as a political tool to weld his empire together. He created a new world order. Have you heard of the story of the Milvian Bridge, where his last opponent, he wonderfully had this vision, and he said that he saw the cross, and it said, in this sign conquer. And the cross, most people think, oh, this is what Constantine saw, isn't that nice? But that's not what he saw, this is what he saw. Pyro. It means something completely different. But this is what was put on the shields of all the Roman insignia was this, and of course, the Roman standard of the eagle. So, Constantine saw what Diocletian, there'd been a 10-year persecution of Christianity, 303 to 313 AD. A lot of Christians were sent to the lions, were persecuted. There was a great slaughter. It says at the time of Smyrna, in the second church of Revelation, that you will have tribulation 10 days. And there was this 10-year period under Diocletian where a lot of the Christians were killed. But the more they killed the Christians, the more people became Christian. And Constantine goes, if you can't beat them, join them and corrupt them. That's what he did. And this is the passage that Haskell is talking about. Actually, I don't think I need this up here. I didn't get to read too much further with this, but this is talking about Constantine, and then he's talking about Justinian. If I can just follow through, if you just bear with me. He also mentions here that it says, it is a fact worth noting that the city was founded. This is Constantinople. It was founded in the year 330 BC. I think he means 330 AD. Well, no, 330 BC. Exactly 360 years, a time after the victory of Octavius over Anthony at Actium, which placed him as the sole ruler of the Roman throne. 330 BC.
That wasn't in Rome.
No. I'm a bit confused by that. Have to go back and study some of these things. But this, basically, the emphasis that I understand that Haskell is talking about is this process here is leading up to Justinian. And with that concept, with that idea of Justinian, it says for the ships in verse 30, it says he shall be grieved and return and have indignation against the Holy Covenant. So shall he do. He shall even return and have intelligence with them that forsake the Holy Covenant. Now we come to verse 31. An arm shall stand on his part, and they shall pollute the sanctuary of strength, and shall take away the daily, and they shall and shall place the abomination that maketh desolate. So if you're feeling completely lost, then that's all right. This really comes to the engine room of Adventism. We're bringing in a whole lot of stuff here that's like, well, we're talking about covenants, we're talking about the setting up, this is the time of the papal supremacy, when and what is the daily? Well, let me just be very blunt here. Most men that have been trained as Adventist ministers in the last 50 years do not teach the daily that our pioneers taught. They teach a very different daily. They teach the daily of Conradi. They teach the daily of Jones. In 1905, after he joined himself to Kellogg. And so these verses become really problematic if we don't have these things sorted out. And yet, if it says Daniel 11 is going to be repeated, and bang, these are the verses that are saying this is a significant point. You need to understand this. If you want to understand a history that's being repeated, you need to know what this is. But Satan has been putting layer upon layer of confusion upon these verses so that we just look at that and go, oh, I've got no idea. Most people will teach you when it says pollute the sanctuary of strength that this is the ministry of Jesus, and this is the popes and his cardinals and priests that are obscuring the work of Jesus in the most holy place in heaven. It's not what our pioneers taught. The sanctuary of strength was Rome. They polluted it, and of course they moved the capital to Constantinople, and they put down the last of the Arian tribes, and they set up the abomination that makes desolate. And they
it wasn't just Rome though; it was paganism as a system of worship.
Paganism as a system of worship.
Rome honored all forms of paganism, didn't it?
It did. It honored all forms of pagan worship, and it took paganism and it badged it in Christianity and brought it up into the church, but acting as if it was destroying it. So
not the daily sacrifice.
The word sacrifice is supply.
No, but the word daily there.
Yeah.
Done here is pretty frequently equated to the daily sacrifice.
Absolutely. Yeah. It's often equated to, because the word is continuance. The continuance. And there are many things in the sanctuary service that are continual. But the word continuance is also used for your continual rebellion against me. And I think the Assyrians and others, they had their daily sacrifices, and they would use the same term for the paganism. They would use the same term. And I think if we went into a discussion about the daily now, I think everyone was ready to pack up and go home. I think I hope that in this discussion that it will. This is. Hey, I need to go and study this. I need to try and understand this. And if you're saying
no,
I've got no idea. Great. That's the place that you can get on your knees. We're supposed to get on our knees with the scriptures. And we're supposed to ask God, what do these things mean? And if we're saying, look, I'm just trying to work a job, I'm just trying to survive, I'm just trying to keep my head above water. Okay, that we understand that. Pray for those who are trying to study these things, that they will. And then check them out when they share some of these things.
I don't know, Adrian, are you going to share verse 32? Are you going to look at that?
Well, we're going to keep going.
Well, just even if you're not going to keep going, I think it's worth just reading that verse.
Yeah, you want to read it for us?
And such as do wickedly against the covenant shall he corrupt by flatteries. But the people that do know their God shall be strong and do exploits. It's that last part of the verse that seems a very great promise. It's those who know God are going to do, what's it? Shall be strong and do exploits.
And this is knowing that this history is going to be repeated. That those who know their God, those who know the true God of heaven, will do great exploits. That's what we're promised.
I see it as Revelation 13 being fulfilled with the mark of the beast.
As the
abomination.
The repeating.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Somebody say that. No. I just wanted to highlight that point. Coming up to verse 30 and 31, but if with your permission, I just wanted to look at a couple more things towards the end of the chapter where there's a lot of confusion, and I want to share some things. Because 33, 34, and 35 are talking about the Christian persecution, a lot of the martyrdoms that are taking place under this transgression of desolation over the 1260-year period. And it says, and I'll just read, and they that understand among the people shall instruct many, yet they shall fall by the sword and by flame and by captivity and by spoil many days. Look, mine says many, many is supplied there, but still in that context it is many days. But if there's a repeating of this history, and remember Justinian, What we need to understand is that the Roman Empire at the time of Justinian was crumbling, was falling apart. The barbarian hordes were coming down and sacking Rome and destroying Rome. It needed to maintain its power. It needed to maintain its grasp. And that's where it turned to the papacy. America is in a precarious position. It's about to completely collapse under its financial misdealings and everything that it's doing. Morally, everything... Every other way, it's about to collapse. And I think we believe that Rome is going to come to its aid. But there will be a price to pay, and that is that it sets up the abomination of desolation. That it brings in an enforcement of a Sunday law. And
it's bizarre. Like, how can the papacy come up and morally support America with all this child abuse that's just going on? Like, it's just bizarre. And yet it's doing that.
But Pope Francis is a good guy, isn't he?
Maybe, but the system.
He's got the gold.
Yeah,
that's right.
He's got the gold. So we're seeing a repeating of, at least I'm seeing a repeating of history, or what seems to be a repeating of history in that regard. And in that understanding, that they that understand among the people shall instruct many, yet they shall fall by the sword and by the flame of captivity and by spoil. There's going to be a lot of heartache ahead for God's people, based on what the spirit of prophecy is saying, that this is going to be repeated. Now, when they shall fall, they shall be holpen with a little help, but many shall cleave to them with flatteries. Many of God's people will be allured away from their allegiance to the one true God and his son Yeshua the Messiah. When you're facing death, that's when you find out what you really believe. And some of them, verse 35, shall understand. Some of them of understanding shall fall to try them and to purge and to make them white, even to the time of the end, because it is yet for an appointed time. When is the time of the end, according to Daniel?
12.
abomination.
Sorry?
After 1260.
1260?
1790. The end of that period, that vision, that prophecy.
The end of this prophecy, yeah. And as it talks in Daniel 12, it says 12:4, but thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro. The book of Daniel was sealed until it says in Revelation chapter 10 that the little book was open. That was 1798 when the Pope was taken captive. So this is talking about the time of the end. So when it says, because it is yet for the at the time of the end, this is important, because verse 36 is the next point where Adventists just go all kinds of different directions. Who is the person in verse 36? Let's just read through some of this, and I'll read this. And the king shall do according to his will, and he shall exalt himself and magnify himself above every god, and shall speak marvelous things against the God of gods, and shall prosper till the indignation be accomplished, for that is determined shall be done. Neither shall he regard the God of his fathers, nor the desire of women, nor regard any god, for he shall magnify himself above all. Who is this? We've come to the time of the end. This is the thing. The time of the end, 1798. Who is doing this this work at the time of the end? Pope, February 17, I think it was, February 11, 1798. Pope's taken captive.
By Majorless Power.
Pope's taken captive by who?
Napoleon. General.
Berthier, who just happened to be a Huguenot. A little bit of revenge for the St. Bartholomew Massacre.
Maybe.
Maybe. I don't know if Napoleon knew that much, but it's a little bit of interesting history. So this king, it says, he shall not regard any god. Did the papacy ever not regard any god?
He regarded many gods.
It regarded many gods. So who is the one power that has in its legislation not regarded any god?
French Revolution.
So this power, it says, neither shall regard the God of his fathers. The papacy was the first son of the Pope, the God of his fathers.
French desired a lot of women.
Sorry? Well, the French is what, in the Bible it says, a woman's desire shall be towards her husband. And the French actually changed the divorce laws. And they changed the whole makeup of the way that the laws were governing marriage. So the desire of women, a woman's desire is towards her husband. And they changed all that. They changed it completely. And we're living in the death throes of that kind of... At least that's what Haskell and Uriah Smith and Haskell both come together on verse 36. They join back up at that particular point, and they go together from this point. It says, but in his estate shall he honour the God of forces and a God whom his fathers knew not. When the French were coming through the streets, they said, if you want to worship a god, they took a prostitute and stuck her up and said, if you want someone to worship, worship this, the goddess of reason. Nobody had ever heard of this before. This was, and of course, the God of Forces, Napoleon's bayonet and his cannon, and all those things. It says, "Shall he honor with gold and silver and precious stones and pleasant things?" The point is that if this is France, that has an effect on verse 40. Right. If it's the papacy, or like as we're coming down into verse 40, is it the papacy that we're talking about, or is it France? Our pioneers said it was France that is this power. Most people today say it's the papacy. James White had the feeling that it was the papacy. But James White, for whatever reason, his wife asked him not to agitate his point. She didn't say he was wrong, she just said, not now. And he never got back to it. So I don't know why that is. But it says in verse 40, at the time of the end. So let's think about this carefully. When when it says in the book of Daniel, at the time of the end, what time are we talking about? 1798. Most people will say just before Jesus comes. No, it's 1798 that these things are occurring. And it says that the king of the south shall push at him, and the king of the north shall come against him. So, this is what's important, is that when it says the king of the south shall push at him, who is the him? We've been talking about France up until this point. Okay? So, let me give you a bit of history. In 1798, if I can draw this, the Nile Delta, if we've done it, get the boot of Italy going up there like that. What we have occurring in 1798, after Napoleon takes the Pope prisoner, it's better if I read it to you. Read a bit of the history so that and hopefully we won't get to the point where some of you say, boy, I should have gone home. This is a drag. The beginning of the year 1798 found France, this is page 290, France indulging in immense projects against the English. And so Napoleon convinces the Directory, that's the French government, that Egypt was the vulnerable point through which to strike at England by intercepting her eastern trade. So the issue was to strike at England. This is what they were wanting to do. So what the French do, they take 50,000, they come from over here, and they come and they land in Egypt, and Egypt was ruled by, at that stage, by some guys called the Mamluks, which were of Islamic Islamic background. And when Napoleon comes, this Muslim force that was looking after Egypt, looking after suppressing Egypt, was squashed. Napoleon just squashed. And so the King of the South, which was, and of course the King of the South is this area here, King of the North is the area up here in terms of all the discussion that's being had. And the Islamic power in the South pushes Napoleon, he crushes it. And then he turns and he starts to head north. Napoleon starts to head north to take on the Sultan of Turkey. Now, something happens around this time as, because a lot of people say, oh, Napoleon says the King of the North is Turkey. And that's selling Uri Smith very short, because what he's talking about here is there was a power that was backing Turkey. Or there was a power that was using Turkey as a front to fight its war and also fought alongside it. And it says here that the French fleet, which was the only channel of communication with France, was destroyed by the English under Nelson. So Lord Nelson comes along and smashes the French fleet. So the English are directly involved, they're trying to stop the French. And then, this is what's really interesting, after Nelson destroys the French fleet, the king of the guy called the King of the North here in Syria, the Sultan of Turkey, he declares war on France. That's very big of him. After the French fleet is destroyed, he declares war on France. And do you know what day that he declared war on France?
September 11.
That's an interesting date, isn't it? September 11, he declares war on France. And that's... And then it says, the Sultan of Turkey, under feelings of jealousy against France, artfully fostered by the English ambassadors at Constantinople, and exasperated that Egypt, so long semi-dependent on the Ottoman Empire, should be transformed into a French province, declared war. There was also Russian influence. It says later on in 293, that Russia and England were working to stop France. So it was really a war between France and England that was being played out, but it was being played out in the Middle East. Hey, is something like that going on at the moment? A war between big Western powers being fought out in the Middle East at this particular time. We're seeing a bit of a repeat of that history. But then at the many ships, the English and the Russians, they cooperate, bringing many ships, and Napoleon for the first time is driven back and he has to retreat and he's completely defeated. And so what this is describing in these verses here, verses 40 to 41, 42, 43 and 44, all this happened between 1798 and 1801. But most people who quote these verses are talking about actually being the actual fulfillment of this occurring right now. But the point I'm wanting to make is that if Spirit of Prophecy says that these passages are being repeated, then that history that occurred in 1798 to 1801 doesn't need to be tossed out, doesn't need to be pushed aside, it needs to be anchored, and we need to see how this history is going to repeat. There'll be a repeating of this history. That's probably the biggest point that I wanted to make. So, and this is the point, because it says, at the time of the end. When you listen to people say, at the time of the end, and they say, just before Jesus comes, and this is going to be the fulfillment of Daniel 11, 40-45, time of the end is 1798. And, yes, we can look for a repeating of that history. A repeating. And so, you have an interesting scenario, and I'm just laying this out for you, that France is a secular, atheistic power, and it comes in and it slams into an Islamic power, and then it is beaten back by England and Russia backing a front which is an Islamic power. We're looking for a repeat maybe of what's going on and what would be a repeat of that situation. Is there going to be a crushing of Islamic forces by a secular led coalition, and then it will destroy and break the back of a lot of the Islamic power, and then this power will then try and take on the power of the papacy, because Russia at that stage was Russian Orthodox, and I don't know how much influence the papacy had over the Russian Orthodox Church at that stage, how active the Jesuits were, but it's interesting. And that's what I'm saying, we need to look for the patterns now between what happened. And again, the point I'm making in Daniel 11, 40 to 45 is most people think it's only two powers that are attacking each other, whereas our pioneers taught that it was three powers. It was a tri-war. There was three powers involved. And that's what I want to bring our attention to in looking at this subject. And have a read of Uriah Smith, have a read of Haskell, and then say, well, Father, how do these things repeat? But I hope that, and I'm sure that anyone here with a little bit of study of Uriah Smith and Stephen Haskell going over Daniel 11, well, you'd start to pick it up fairly quick. If you come into this and not having done any of the previous reading, it's going to be like... It's going to be pretty heavy. So, maybe we should end it there. Father in heaven, I know that we've looked at some challenging things, and I pray that you will guide our minds on these subjects. They're important. And I pray that we'll take away with us the thought that what's happening in Daniel 11, 40 to 44, is something that happened back in 1798. But that this history is being repeated, and that what happened in the time of 508 with Justinian and the setting up of the abomination of desolation, that this will happen again just before the coming of Christ, as it says in Matthew 24, and that we will ask you, Lord, we want to ask you. We need more light. We need more understanding of these things. Show us, open our minds and give us understanding. And we thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.